My name is Naomi Black. I'm a technical program manager on the Angular team. And as you can hear from my voice, I'm recovering from a cold. So we're going to have a slightly abridged intro to Angular presentation tonight, which I hope you will forgive me for. And if you've missed the intro to Angular presentation, if you're totally new and you know nothing about Angular and you want the slightly longer version of it, if you go to our YouTube channel, you can see it at the beginning of the previous meetup, which is posted on YouTube. So tonight, I'll start by telling you what we're going to do. We're going to start off with the intro to Angular, and then there will be food and drinks and snacking and socializing, hopefully. And then Wes Alvaro is here. Wes is a Googler, and he's going to give a talk on demystifying dependency injection in Angular, and he's going to show you lots of examples from code. And then we're going to have Greg is going to give a talk on design patterns from sophisticated UIs. And after that, we're going to have some Q&A. And then I'm guessing tonight we'll wrap up a little bit early, around 8:30, 8:40. And so for the Q&A, I'm kind of the pinch hitter tonight. If you've been following us on Google+, you know that Mishko and Vojta and Igor are all in Europe this week, presenting at DevOx and other conferences. So I've only been on the Angular team about a month myself, so I'm not the person you want answering your Q&A yet. So I thought I would ask all of you. I know from your answers when you signed up for the meetup that many of you are experts or have a lot of experience on Angular. So if you would be willing to answer questions at the Q&A, maybe you could come up and let me know at when we break for snacks. And then I will point you out later, and during the socializing, if people have questions, they can come up and ask you, or we can use the mic at the end. So anyways, welcome. I'm really glad to see you all here. Out of curiosity, how many people here are totally new? This is your first meetup, and you're really kind of new to Angular. Wow, now I feel badly for not having enough ways to get through the entire intro talk. Welcome. I'm really excited to see so many new faces. So what is Angular? When we started thinking about how we write code, when I first started writing code, it was a very sort of intuitive process. There was something I wanted the machine to do. I told the machine to do it, and then I ran my code, and it just happened. And it was this really very simple process of going from the idea of what I wanted to do to the code running and something happening. And today with modern web applications, we can do all kinds of amazing interactive dynamic things with people all over the world in many different kinds of browsers. And for the user, that experience can be really simple and transformative. But for the programmer, this experience in modern web browsers has become really painful. We've come a long way from the point where you could say, here's what I want to do, and then it would just magically happen in the browser across all different browsers. So when we started thinking about Angular and what we wanted to do, what we really wanted to do was to bring the idea of structure into programming for dynamic web-based apps. So what is Angular? When I was learning Angular, this is the question that I felt like the obvious thing nobody told me, so I'm going to put it up here. And I can see I should use a heavier font. What Angular is basically it's a set of libraries that you can include in your web application. And those libraries allow you to then write code in the browser that's structured and clean. And the reason this is important is because if you can write your code in a nice, structured, clean way, it's easier for other developers to understand. They can go in and they can read it, and they can see, oh, I see what you meant to do here. This is really clear. And they can then pick up your code, they can extend it, they can work with you. It's also really important for testability. If you think about the way a lot of web applications are built today, all of the pieces are kind of together, and it's hard to test things when everything is together in the one page of the browser's rendering. So Angular brings some structure that helps us improve both the testability and the codability of what we're building in web applications. Sadly, you can hear from my voice, this is about all the intro I'm going to be able to get through. So I apologize. I'm going to give you some links to other places you can find more information. And you'll also get more of a taste in our talks. So let me go back to my browser window. So if you are, let me make this full screen. Let's make this a little smaller so you can see all of it. So if you're totally new to Angular and you don't know where to go for help, Start with angularjs.org. That's our homepage. And if you go look on our homepage, there's a link directly to GitHub where you can get the code. You can download it. You can work offline. And the code includes things like examples and docs and demos. And then you can scroll down here, and there's an interactive tutorial that will start teaching you the basics of Angular. So angularjs.org is really the starting point for all the information we have. We also have a site called builtwithangularjs.org, and this site is a place where you can go to find demo examples, things that other people have built that are actually not just demos, but real working applications. And if you've built something cool with Angular and you haven't told us about it yet, you should know that if you submit something and we post it here, not only will you get the glory of having people being able to find your application and admire it, but we'll also send you an Angular t-shirt. So I'll give you an example of some of the things you can do. If you're just learning how to do something, it can be helpful to find examples of other people who've done that. So here under tags, I can search and I can say, okay, I want to find examples of people who've done applications using Bootstrap. So if I click here, then it filters to only show me examples of things that include Bootstrap. And you can see there's a whole bunch of other tags on different topics. So when you submit something, we also ask you to tell us some tags so we can help other people find it. So this is built with angularjs.org. We have a blog, creatively named blog.angularjs.org. You can find links to all these things from our homepage as well. And we post sort of longer pieces about this, links to other blog posts, explanations, things that we're working on right now, places you can find us. We also post on Google+. If you want to keep up with sort of news and where the team is and things we think are cool on the web, you can follow us as we're just AngularJS on Google+. We have a Twitter feed at AngularJS. This is our YouTube channel. I'm still surprised there's some people who keep asking where the videos are from the meetups. This is where the videos are from the meetups. And it's just youtube.com/AngularJS. And if you go and you look here, you'll see we have actually a playlist of not only our videos, but you can find a link to a playlist that has Angular videos that we found elsewhere on YouTube. So if you know of an awesome video and we're not linking to it here, please drop us a note and let us know so we can link it in. And you'll find tutorials, meetup videos, all kinds of things. And then we have our support forum, which is on groups.google.com, and the forum name is just Angular. And we have a community of developers here. So if you have a question, whether you're completely new to Angular and you're really running into trouble trying to get your first application working, or you're very experienced and you have kind of a thorny question, or you think you found a bug and you'd like to talk to somebody about it, this group is the best place to go to sort of post those questions. And we have a number of people in the community who've sort of been on the group for a long time, who are established, who really help out answering questions on there. And some of them are probably even here. Are any of the people who are contributors on the group here? No, not today. They haven't got here yet. They're skipping the intro part because they know it's like, oh, it's the old stuff. Okay, so that's the end of my very short intro. I will return you to some socializing and snacks. And let's see, what time is it now? It is 6:30. So let's do, I don't know, socializing and snacks for, say, another 10 minutes. And at 6:40, we'll start with Wes's talk. Okay, so if everybody's got some snacks and food and some socializing in, we're going to get started with Wes's talk. I'm curious if anybody else has had an onset of some Q&A bravery for later. I should have mentioned that we have T-shirts with our spiffy Angular logo. If you can answer a question from somebody from the audience, I will be very grateful. And we have T-shirts. And otherwise, you can save your questions for when Mishko is back in December at our next meetup. So, Wes, I'm going to hang the mic over to you.
All right. Thanks, Naomi. So, I want to see you again. So, who here knows JavaScript? Okay. This is good. So, I almost say everybody. Most people are new to Angular. Let's do that hand raise on new to Angular. Never written Angular code or like Hello World? Okay. So one of the first things you'll find out about Angular is that there's dependency injection everywhere. And it's very important, but we'll get off with who I am. I'm Wes. I'm a software engineer here at Google. I don't actually work anything to do with Angular other than I love using it in my own projects. I started using it about, half a year ago, I guess. So we pretty much adopted it to do everything that we do. So we really enjoy it. We use it with Clojure. It's very nice. I'm obsessed with it. But if any of you guys know anything that I don't, I really don't know what I'm doing. So if you have anything, if I say anything stupid, call me out on it, please. I don't want to, like, warp your minds. But the agenda today is that we'll talk about the provider in Angular and its methods, value, constant, service, factory, decorator, provider. And then we'll actually get our hands dirty with creating our own service. And by service, I really mean app here. So we'll be using the Gappy JavaScript API client that is really cool for making your apps work with Google APIs. So we'll take that as like an actual working example. Everything else is really contrived. And even this is pretty contrived. I tried to use as much of these functions as I could just to illustrate their use. So why should you care? Well, dependency injection. I don't know if you know about dependency injection, but if you don't, you should, because it's awesome. So dependency injection means that you get modularization, right? You write some code over here, you write some code over there, you inject it into the one, everything's separate, everything's nice, everything's testable. So testing is also the big reason, right? So if you have something that's injected, then you can inject whatever you want in there, especially in JavaScript, where you got duct typing, right? So when you have duct typing, you can shove anything you want in there in your tests to make it easy to test, to make it nice to test, to make it fun to test. So, testing in JavaScript, it's pretty fun because of duct typing itself. But when you throw in dependency injection, it makes it even better because you're not like duck punching all those things, right? So let's get started. How do you get data into your app? Well, you're going to use these various providers. So they're injected singletons with a get method, essentially, right? So what does that mean? Well, there's a few different methods that we'll be looking at, and each of them kind of has their own place. And since you guys are new, feel free to stop me because I kind of skipped over, you know, the intro stuff. And since Naomi's not feeling well, she did as well. But all of this should be really familiar if you at least look at the website. You should see it all kind of follows the same patterns. But we'll see if you have any questions. Feel free to raise your hand, and I'll try to answer anything that I know. So the first method that we're going to talk about is constant. So once you've created your module, we'll name it foo, right? You might want to create a constant to go in your module. In this case, I've created a constant called Jellybean, and the value is 4.2, right? So what does this mean? A constant is a value that you can inject anywhere. So any module later on that depends on this module, or anywhere in this module, I can inject a value called Jellybean, and the value will be 4.2. Now, something we'll learn about later is the decorator. And I mentioned here that it cannot be intercepted by a decorator, which means that once a constant, always a constant. You can't change it down the line. You can always expect it. So a good constant example might have been pi, right? Pi is always 3.14, whatever. So in that case, you don't ever want anybody to change the value of pi anywhere along the line. That's what you use constants for. We'll go into more like a working example of how to use this, but I also have examples linked here. Obviously, you can't click on these, but there'll be a link to these slides, which I encourage you all to go look at later, since I spent a lot of time making plunkers. So just to make sure I'm not crazy, my own sanity checks as well. So even if it doesn't work out for you guys, it worked for me. Value. So this is the next. I didn't put these in any kind of order other than the order that I thought made the most sense. So we talked about constant. It's a constant value. But how is that different from value? Well, values aren't constant values. They're just values. So they're just simply injectable values into anywhere, but they can't be injected into configurations. And we'll see that later, too, why that's important. But essentially, they work the same as constants. They can't be put into configurations, but they can be intercepted by decorators, which we'll also talk about later. But for the main point of these two functions is that they just have values. So I've given both primitive values, right? The one's a number, one's a string. But it could be anything. It could be a function. It could be an object, which we all know they're all objects, but you know what I'm saying. But it's just any value that I stick there. That's what I get later when I inject it. We have a service. Yes, Naomi. That's a bummer. I could do like, there's like high contrast mode here somewhere, isn't there? Oh, yeah. That's just Alt Control Command 8, if you're ever curious on a Mac. So anyway, so we can see this now, right? We're gonna go back to constant. So you got your app, if that's a module, app.constant. It is inverted. I don't know how to uninvert. I don't know how to do what you're saying, though. I've got those two options. I don't know.
I think the other one was actually bad.
Oh, really? You like the black on the with the white and black? I guess the code is what you can't really see there. Yeah, I can go over. I can read out the code since it's not very contrasty. So yeah, we finished value, moving on to service. So this is where it gets interesting. So up until this point, everything that we've been creating for injection is just flat values. Now, all of these essentially use the provider service in an interesting way to provide these values, and we'll look at that later too. But this one is the first one that actually gets injected itself. So at this point, we're creating a service called API. API is totally contrived. Service is really just an injectable constructor, right? So you can see that method there takes some kind of dependency, and that dependency can be anything that we've declared as injectable. It could be anything from the Angular library like HTTP. It could be our jelly bean from earlier or our name. It can be anything. But what this does is this actually calls the instantiation function with those dependencies on this function here, right? So what we'll get, this would obviously, you could make it anything. It doesn't have to be inline, right? This could be an object you've created with various prototypes somewhere else. But it's just going to get constructed with whatever dependencies you specify. So if you're new to Angular, you might understand how it actually knows what to inject. And that part is magic. So Angular picks out the arguments to the function itself and then pulls those from the dependency injector and gives them to your function. It's all very magical, but if you give it something that it's not already provided, then it's going to whine at you, right? Because everything in Angular has to have a provider to be injected. So what do we use services for? Well, we already explained that constants are just numbers like pi. We got values. You can change those values later with a decorator. We'll explain that. But what do you use a service for? Well, a service is good, and this is one of those things that it's one of those aha moments in Angular. Once you figure out how to use them, you never realize how you went on without them to begin with. But when you have various controllers in your app that you will inevitably have, you're going to want to like transfer data between them or like cache data, right? So in this case, we'll use a service for that in that you can inject that service into as many of those controllers as you want or any other service or other things that we'll talk about. And in that way, you can share data, you can share those methods between them, and it's all done for you magically by Angular. You don't have to worry about creating those objects yourself. Angular will actually create these the first time they're used. So in the case of a service, you have to worry about like memory wasted that you're creating the service all the time. If you never use it in your module, that you're just providing it as a library for later modules, then it'll never get instantiated until those modules later down the line actually use it, which is pretty cool. But it's important to note that all of these only get instantiated once. So no matter how many times you reference a service or how many times you reference a factory, they only happen once. And we'll see how that kind of works out, plays in our favor. It might be confusing for you maybe later. But in general, a service is a way that you can stay out of the global namespace, right? You can just inject your services. It's amazing. A factory. So factories are a lot like services. A factory is an injectable function for returning factory stuff. It's really scientific. But what that means is, this is just a function. It's not a constructor. It's not anything special. It's a function. So in this case, though, the function does get injected. We see here I've got dep in there. That's sticking whatever you want that's provided to create a factory widget. So how does this differ from a service? Well, again, a constructor creates an object, right? So new is called on a service. But in a factory, it's just going to call this function and return to you when you inject it later, whatever the return value was. So that's why I have return question mark. You can return whatever you want. So in this case, widget, when I inject it later, I could have my function here return 1. The widget value is 1. And so we can see here that it's a lot like maybe just the value function, if we want it to be, right? So if my function just returns 1, it's the same as saying, give me a value with the value 1, like we saw earlier. We're all staying with me? Cool. So it's a provider, so we'll talk about providers next, with only a get method. So providers are really interesting, and then they're just factories with a get method. So I have two examples of this, because you can use either a function. Yes?
So when you inject that factory or widget,
mm-hmm.
Is it only instantiated once?
So he asked, when I inject widget, the factory, is it only instantiated once? Yes, that function is only called once ever. Correct. That's up to you and the value that you return to do something special with it. So you're essentially creating a factory. This isn't a factory, right? Does that make sense? Okay, cool. Yeah, so I have here an example for two different ways of doing it, I believe. But you should check those out later, too. Now we'll talk about the oh, yes. That is correct for all of these. Oh, yes, sorry. He asked, he wanted to make sure that a factory, I'm sorry.
A factory is only called at the time of construction of the object.
Yes. Okay, he asked if it's only called at the time of construction of the object, wherever you're injecting it, right? Yeah. So in this case, yes. So factories, all of these, they're only instantiated once, whether it's just creating the value, whether it's creating the factory and calling this function, whether it's creating the service and calling new on that function, they're only created once. So when you inject it into controller A, controller B, you know, service A, service B, it's going to get the same object. The first one to call it, the first one to get injected into, that's going to be the one that sets it up, but they're both going to get the same result, the same return value will be given to both. Mm-hmm.
Let me just ask one more thing.
Sure.
The difference between factory and service.
Mm-hmm.
Basically, the only difference is that the service uses new and the factory is just called directly?
That is correct. Okay. Yes, and we will see that in a minute. I have some a summary kind of slide that shows you the differences. But service is actually implemented with factory in the code.
Okay.
So, yes. It's just a nice little way you just throw in a constructor, right? So now we have a decorator, and the decorator is a really cool way to work with your app. And it was really easy to find a way to use it when I contrived my example we'll talk about in a few minutes, because it's actually really neat. What this does is, in this case, I have a module app, and I have my config function. And so to my config function, I'm injecting the provide service, right? So provide is what all these functions use underneath. All the ones that we've been talking about, they all use provide. And this is another method on the provide. This one is not available on the module like the other ones were. This one is only provided by provide. Anyway, so I'm decorating a provision called name. So we saw name I named earlier. It was Larry, right? So here, Larry is getting inserted into this delegate variable. It's being injected there as delegate. And so what I do to it is I say delegate plus the great. So in this case, if I'm injecting the name provision and the name is Larry, this simply changes such that anywhere later in the code that uses the dependency injection of the name provision is now not Larry, it's Larry the Great. Cool, huh? So in this way, you can have your top-level module. You can have your modules that depend on that module. And then if there's anything that's a value or anything that's a service, as it says here, if there's anything upstream that you want to take care of that's not a constant, then you can do it here. Because we talked about constants can't be changed by decorators. Constants are always constant. But anything you need to change, you can change with a decorator. It's pretty neat. Now we go to the lowest level, the actual provider method that I told you that all of these actually use underneath. And so what happens in the provider method is just variations on what we've seen. So the provider method takes the name of your provision, so in this case foo, and then it can take either an object or a function. So I forgot my dependency here. My bad. Oh no. I'm not sure how it got that. Oh geez. We'll leave it alone. All right. So, no, I didn't. It's right there. I didn't forget it anyway. So here we've got foo, and these are two different options for how to create foo. So one uses the object version, and then one also uses the function version. This is actually not a function. It's a constructor. Sorry. So in this case, the object, all it has to have to be a proper provider, and if you don't have it, Angular will tell you this because it has to be there, is this get property. So what the get property is whenever you inject your provision into some service later, or some module or whatever later, it's going to call that get method, and that's the value that it gives to the as the return value of the injection. So in this case, it's going to inject this function with whatever dependencies I ask, and the return value of this function is going to be what gets injected. So you can see here, it's a little bit overkill for the various ways you can use it up above, right? So we talked about the constant. So in this function, I could just say return 3.14 and name it pi, right? That's the same thing. But in this case, it's much clearer to just say app.constant pi is 3.14. So you wouldn't go through all these nitty-gritty steps. The same with the other one. So this gets instantiated and then treated just like the object. So it's still got to have its get method on there. And that's what you're seeing there. It's the same thing. So in that way, this gives you kind of more storage options, I said. But I guess, you know, it's an object. You can treat it how you want. So you can create whatever you want. You're not confined to these methods that are set up for you if you don't want to. So, yeah, that's about that. Any questions? All right, so you have a pop quiz. You didn't know you were getting quizzed. So this is a few lines of code. So it's meant to be confusing, but it's really simple, trust me. So these are all the functions that I've just talked about, right? A few of them are a couple different ways of doing it, but you start on line one, you get app.value, v is 7. And I put this just so there's a concrete example there, right? So I'm declaring a value v with the value 7. Now the ones below there, I've got three different calls to config. I've got a call to constant, I've got a call to factory, to run, to service, and a value again. I've also got a controller that I've set up that injects a lot of these into it. So what I want you to figure out is if you can see the problem here. So we've talked about this problem a couple times, mentioned it at least. If you can't, it's no big deal. I know it's hard to read, first of all. Plus, it's a lot of junk on the screen. But if you can find it in the next 30 seconds, I'll wait on you while I talk. Yeah?
Is it that you're injecting a value?
You're very close. What?
In the second app.config?
That is correct. You cannot inject a value into an app.config, right? So, well, I would delete it, but I'm afraid I'm going to email myself again. But yes, so that second app.config line with function v, so it would try to inject v into that configuration function, but it would fail because v is a value and values don't get injected into config functions. So that kind of shows you the one caveat of using values over constants. But sometimes it's one of those things you have to do. So app.config can't take a value. Now my next question is, Actually, let me check in. Okay, don't look at that. I'm curious to see if you know which order that these things happen. So this way, it gives you a better understanding of how these actual dependencies work. So I guess you're missing the understanding of the config function, maybe, and that the config function is called essentially before anything can be injected, right? Like, that's the reason you can't inject V, is because the dependency injector hasn't been completely set up yet. So it's pretty much the first thing that happens. That's a hint. So if you were to guess, what happens first? I've given you these nice little names over to the side of those functions. You could reference them by that. Or you could just say the variable name in the case of the other ones. No? You already peaked? What is it? Correct. Yes. So we start off with config C, because that's the first config. It's JavaScript, right? It's all linear. So config C happens first. We get config P, because config V, remember, is not valid. So that's actually stricken from the record. We get the run next. So run happens after the dependency injector is finalized. So in that case, you see here, I'm actually injecting V into run, and that's totally cool. Dependency injector has been set up. I inject it there. Everything works fine. Factory happens next. Now, why does factory happen next? Any guesses? Yeah? Yes. So the factory here, we can see in the controller, we're injecting V, C, W, F, P, and S. And our factory is named F. So we see it there, F. It is the first thing that actually has a function attached to it that gets injected. So we've got the provide next, because again, so we up here, P comes after F. So that function is going to happen next. And we'll see that printed out if we had a log in there, which this proof down the bottom shows you that this is not all made up. And then the service happens last, so it's the last argument there. Now you're thinking, why don't I see V or C or W in that list of things that happened? Well, because this was supposed to be if I had console.logs and all these empty braces. So in this case, that's a little hint for this next question. Why aren't there going to be console.logs when I create my my constants and my values? Well, in this case, here, I'll let you guess. So what's the value inside of my controller for V? What type is it? Huh? It's not a trick question. It's a number. Yes, it's a number. And then C? This might be a little trick question.
Object?
It is an object. What kind of object is it?
Literal?
No.
Undefined?
Huh?
Undefined? Oh,
see?
It's an array.
See the app.constant? Let's see if I can highlight it here. This guy right here. Can we see it? It is a function object. Correct. Because it's literally whatever I put as that second parameter, right? So it's not getting injected like the factory methods, etc. It's literally that function object that I say is C. So what's V then? Or W? Double V. It's a function. That's correct. Yes. It's the same reason, right? It's literally whatever value I put as that second parameter, and that second parameter is a function. So it's a function argument. That's why you don't see those console.logs if you ran this set of code. So after, let's see here. Oh, I'm still not there yet. So we covered W. What's F? Well, yeah, what does it return? Literally in that code. Nothing. It's undefined, right? So then P is also maybe undefined as well. So we've got C as our function. Our F is undefined. This is why it threw me off. That's not supposed to be there. So I got P twice. So P is undefined, but S, I ruined it. S is an object, right? Because it's not literally that undefined that gets returned. It's getting called with new. So S is just an empty object here. Cool, huh? So you kind of see how those differ? So this is the exact same code across all of these. And so this should show you essentially how all these methods differ and how you can still kind of accomplish the same thing with that P, right? P there is working just like the factory F. Pretty cool. So I have this playground here. It was more like a Q&A type break for me. But if you were curious as to how something worked as another thing, I could, and I don't know if I'm going to email myself, so hopefully not. But in this case, okay, we're looking good. All right. So in this case, like I told you earlier, we could have this pi, right? So if we wanted to create a constant here, and you can't really create a constant because constants really are special, but we could say 3.14. And so that's like creating a constant. It's more like creating a value, actually. So this is how you would create the value pi with the provider function. It's kind of neat. So if we wanted to create maybe a service, right? Or let's do a factory. So we could have something like HTTP injected here. And I could maybe return some kind of crazy contrived example here. So I could return. Yeah, whatever. This is going to create me an object that has the method foo on it. You get the idea. So in this way, you can kind of see how this extrapolates out to be pretty much any of those functions we talked about. You can implement them all with the provider, but the provider is going to be a lot nastier to use, as you can tell. Like, look at all this code. I don't want to do this. I just want to say app.factory and then have my function, right? So in that way, does everybody kind of have a grasp on how the provider method works in conjunction with those other ones? And are you afraid of it? No. Shake your heads. No. You shouldn't be. But this is like one of the amazing things about Angular. So this is what really gets me excited. When you first start messing with Angular, you do little bits, right? You do little bits of controllers or whatever. You throw this scope in there, whatever that is, I don't know. And then you add this stuff on there, magic stuff happens, right? But once you really get to understand dependency injection and how it works for you, it really makes creating apps easy. It'll totally flip like the way that you write JavaScript apps on its head. I know it did for me, and it still does. It's one of those learning experiences where when you start out, okay, yeah, that makes sense. But wait a minute, I could do this, and that'd be cool. And so you with Angular, you kind of like build on that. You have your basic knowledge, and then you get dangerous with something like the dependency injector, or you know, directives. Ugh, man, those are crazy. So there's a lot of tools that Angular makes available to you, and you can choose to use them or not. Like, right, you could just have these as constants in some kind of namespace, hopefully. You're not actually using window, but you could just store these somewhere and you know, have your own constants. But Angular will take those values, inject them for you, make sure nobody changes them, allow people to change them, do all the stuff in this nice, you know, very structured way. So it's really cool. So, oh yeah. Let's go with you.
In the last example, you made a factory using a provider.
Uh-huh.
How would you name that factory?
Is it the factory
method, and you give it
the first parameter? Right. He asked, how would I create the name for the factory using the provide? So here I've actually, I probably confused people by doing this. So this could be like bar. So my factory would be named bar. Cool. Did you have a question? Yes.
What's that?
The dollar sign in relation to what? Just in general?
Oh, okay. So how does it work? Like if you're using Juice, there's a module where you kind of wire stuff together
mm-hmm.
and say what interfaces go to what mm-hmm. process, like that. What's the equivalent of that in Angular, and how does that happen, and how does that relate to the dollar sign?
So there's modules in Juice, right?
Yeah.
So modules in Juice work pretty similar to modules in Angular in that you can have a module and When you first get your feet wet with Angular, you'll quickly realize that a module is like your application, right? Like that's what gets bootstrapped when you write your application on the page. But really what a module is a little bit a little bit more than that, right? Like you can create modules, and we'll look at those modules later. You can create modules that are just libraries, and they are essentially what you're talking about. So like with juice injection, you create a module, you say, oh, provide this, provide that, provide that. It's the exact same as creating a module here and saying provider.provide, you know, provide.provider, et cetera. So it's the same thing. And in the case of most of the functions, like factory and the ones we talked about, you'll just do that directly on the module. So you'd say module equals angular.module, give it a name, and then you'd say module.factory, module.constant, and you're good to go.
Okay.
And so then that's going to be your dependent module later, whenever you want to use those things.
That makes sense. And I have another one, too.
I didn't answer your question about the dollar sign, though. The dollar sign is superfluous. So they use dollar sign just to mark Angular things.
So it doesn't need to be there?
For which specific thing?
So if you have, I guess I'm not getting, like if you have a HTTP service, how does that exactly, like what is that?
So in this case, the HTTP with a dollar sign, I know that to be the Angular HTTP service.
Right, but if I have a custom one or something.
Then you can name it whatever you want. You can name it flip-flop if you want.
And then how does that map to the actual, car, right? Like, where's the car object that maps to that dollar car? Like, how does that?
So,
your module?
Yes, in your module.
Okay.
So when you create, so this HTTP module was created as a service, and we talked about services a little bit ago. Let me get through. All right. So here, so this could literally we could, and hopefully I don't email myself. All right, good. So this is how I would create the HTTP service. Donezo. So again, this is just a constructor that gets called, and then anywhere I want to inject the HTTP service later, good to go.
Oh, okay. That makes perfect sense.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Cool.
And then is there a trick? I read about this, like to get Angular, JS, DI to work with minifiers, you have to do
Good question. I didn't know we were talking about minifiers. So yes, it's there's two ways to work with minifiers. I prefer one way, but both ways are fine. So in this case, if I have a service, let's say I'm making something else. I'm making something called API, and I actually want to inject the HTTP service, right? So in this case, when my minifier happens, this turns to this, and this might turn to, you know, this, right? And you're like, well, it no longer knows I need the HTTP service. Everything else is fine.
Right.
Everything that's quoted's fine, right? We know that. That's how you'd reference, like, properties, right? Use the quotes instead of the actual name of the property. But what we can do here, and this is the method that I prefer, is we just create an array as the second argument, and we do this. Voila, we've just made safe our service from minifiers. So now Angular looks at that as an array, says I need to inject this as the first argument, and goes at it.
It's not going to minify the string. Sure.
Exactly. Right. And so that works with Clojure or any other minifier you may come across. Now, there's the alternative, and I'll just mention it for brevity or for completeness sake, but I think this is a much more elegant solution. So if I have a service, let's say this is function x. So here I would say x dot, I believe this is correct because I never use this. Huh?
You have to
I was just doing this for shortness, but if you want me to be legit, I'll be legit. Oh, jeez. I just closed it. Let's do a little Control-Shift-T magic, maybe. Oh, no, it's gone. The heck? Oh, this is incognito, that's why. For the demo, it doesn't like me to be logged into multiple accounts at once, so it's weird. Oops. Where are we at? There we are. Let's just take over this one. So in this case, I want to inject this guy, call it F, we'll put it here, we'll say F dot dollar inject, and then we say, like that. So now when this gets renamed to that, we're still good to go. So that's the alternative method. I don't think it's as clear because it doesn't come right together with it. I like to keep all my Angular stuff in one place, and those things can get lost. Who knows where that might end up, right? So that's why I prefer the other method. But both work. So Take what you like. Any more questions? Yes.
I have two more, but I don't know if they're specifically, they're not specifically related to DI. They're more general Angular. Is this the right time to ask them?
Are they short?
Yeah, they're fairly short.
Okay.
Okay, so is there a recommended dependency management solution for Angular which doesn't require listing all JavaScript objects in the application across host page, test, and build? Kind of like something you'd use Wire.js for. How do you guys do that in your apps? Do you use a tool for that?
That was really long.
Okay.
Could you rephrase?
So
I've never used Require.js, so.
So if you don't want to list your job, like if you have 100 JavaScript files,
okay.
You want to list all 100 in your host page,
yeah.
Your testacular config,
yeah.
And your build.
Mm-hmm.
Right? You want to just be a recursive blob for the whole tree, right?
Mm-hmm.
How do you guys do that?
I use the Clojure compiler.
Clojure does that for you.
Clojure does do that for you. The require and the provides there. But I couldn't give you a good answer on that, I don't guess.
That's a good answer.
Okay.
If you, at the last meetup, they went over Yeoman,
yeah.
And they have a technique for combining all the, you list out the JavaScript files and it helps combine them all. But in Angular, it takes a slightly different approach from something like Require.js, in that you kind of just say, here's all my JavaScript files, and because you're using dependency injection, ordering doesn't, depending on how you use it, ordering may not even matter at all. So you just like, here's all my files, I don't really care what order they're put in, and the dependency injection will properly load everything.
Yeah, I watched this.
So.
List every single thing out in the host HTML page, and it just gets kind of like verbose.
Yeah, I mean, so you have to list every required JavaScript file once, right? I mean, you're gonna have to do that somewhere, right?
Not necessarily.
Okay.
That's true. Okay, we could talk more offline.
Okay.
And your second question, is it quick?
Mm-hmm. Went over it, but he didn't really start from scratch. He had some kind of pre-laid code that
mm-hmm.
sort of showed TDD. Is there any examples of video or article which shows like a TDD workflow from scratch in Angular?
Yes. So, it's computer science. Is there? Yes. It might even be best for you to just do it yourself, to be honest. That was what I did. There's lots of videos that I've seen. I didn't want to watch them, I'm going to be honest. I just grabbed Testacular, and I started writing tests, and it was fast, and I kept going. And it was a lot of fun. So definitely recommend Testacular. If you don't know what it is, it's not what it sounds like. It's a great testing library, and it's super fast. So it tests in the browser, it's too fast to even talk about. So. We get back into this. So now we'll talk about our Google APIs. And I want to go through this example. I think, how much time do I have? I'm good? Like, what does that mean? Okay, I'll keep talking. I was worried that I could either not teach anybody anything or that I would just drone on and nobody would care. But I'm glad that we're learning things, so I will take as much time as I want. We'll talk about Google Drive. So who uses Google Drive? Who uses Dropbox? Boo! I'm just kidding. So Google Drive has a really awesome API. I don't know about Dropbox. It's probably got a good API too, because lots of things use Dropbox. But this has a really cool JavaScript API that we'll be using in this demo / hands-on kind of thing. And what we're going to specifically look at is how you can easily search for files and export to various formats. So when you go to Google Drive online, you can say export to PDF, export to RTF, export to, I don't know, whatever. So what we'll be doing is taking that and using gappy.js. So the client library for connecting to all these Google APIs. It's really easy to use, handles OAuth for you, and if for that reason only, you should use it. But this makes it really easy to pass in your scopes, pass in all the kind of cool stuff that you need to get an app working really quickly, and then you can just make calls as if it's a JavaScript object, I remember paths and all that kind of stuff. So we'll be using that combined with the Drive API's files.list And I'm not sure what this example goes to because I don't think I wrote it, but it's probably a good example. So you should look at these slides afterwards and check out all these examples. So I'll go ahead and pimp that again. So the drive.files.list API endpoint lists files from your drive, as you can guess. It does require authentication, but I already said that we'll be using OAuth with the client library, Gappy. It supports search queries, which is cool. It's a pretty inclusive search set. It has built-in pagination, which is also cool. So we'll kind of like lightly touch on all of this, but I hope it'll be informative. I don't know. We'll see. I think it's a cool example. It's a real-world example. So the objective. I finished this one, right? Yeah. The objective. We're going to create a simple app, right? The requirements, it's going to have a search box, and it's going to have a results list that includes some whatever metadata you want to put in there, some thumbnails, because we all like thumbnails, we're visual people, and downloads. We need to download it in PDF, because everybody loves PDFs as well. So on here, I have this, and I will go ahead and try and open this. Oh, no. Oh, no. Oh, okay, we're good. I'm going to hold command while I click it. Yeah?
I can make it go on that screen now.
Oh, really?
I think. Let's save then.
I don't know what's wrong with that information, guys. I'm sorry.
It's really yellow on this screen, though. But if it helps with seeing it, all for it. So I have this example. It's all done for us. So don't figure out where my slides are and go get it. But what we'll be looking at is, of course, dependency injection. So this whole talk's about, right? So I've tried to contrive as much dependency injection as possible. But after I did it, I was like, this is probably how it should be done. So everything is actually dependency injected. I don't have any variables anywhere. And really, I don't input any variables anywhere other than from the website. So it's pretty cool. It's really simple. So don't take this as like some production. There's probably 800 bugs. Don't get picky. But we'll be looking at three modules that I wrote, and this kind of shows you how you'd set up those juice modules like he was asking about earlier. So I have one just for Gappy, and this is where most of the stuff's going to be. Let's see. It's where most of the code is. I have one for Drive. It's just a really simple way to get the actual method call through Gappy. And I also have our app, and that's the app that's going to be presented on the page. So how will we be using this? It's a good question. You think, well, I have the HTTP service in Angular, and the people that are new, this might not make any sense to you, but it will soon, because if you try to use Angular, and this is one of the things that I really didn't know how it worked when I first started using Angular, if you use Angular with something like jQuery, and you say jQuery.get website inserted here, it returns a value, right? But Angular is totally clueless about it, because Angular does not it's not aware of those actions, like jQuery click events. It's not going to handle those. It's going to handle its own click events. It's going to make sure that the scope and all the changes of the scope are dirty checked during Angular events. So that kind of extrapolates out to like the HTTP method calls. Nothing's going to happen if I use a jQuery method call, you know, to some website somewhere, or a Gappy method call to some website somewhere. And this is, I stress to you, this is probably your number one question you'll have, because most of us are not used to writing stuff with you know, these contrived, you know, HTTP.get or whatever. You've already got a way you do it, and you might not want to change. And so if you don't want to immediately change over to using Angular full on, you still want to use those methods you have. There's a few things that will take into account. And specifically, we're going to tame the Ajax with the Q module. So who knows about Q? Cool. So Q, for those of you who don't know, since I was a majority, is a library written by this guy named Chris Kowal. Yes. And Angular actually implements a subset of the, it's a very light. In the same way that they implement a jQuery light, there's like a Q light in Angular. And so what is the Q? Well, if you're familiar at all with deferred objects, promises, if any of this is ringing a bell, what this allows you to do is create these deferred objects that you can resolve or reject at a later point with a value. What does that mean? Well, anything that's like wanting something from there that has that promise, it can depend on the result being either this resolved value or this rejected value. And so in that way, you can have these asynchronous calls and you can just promise them. Here you go, here's a promise. I'll get back to you later when that returns, right? And so in that way, you can, and this is used throughout the Angular code, but in this way you can also use it in your own code with stuff like jQuery, with stuff like Gappy that we're going to look at. Anything that's asynchronous, anything like click events with jQuery or closure click events. I don't know why you'd be using closure click events if you were using Angular, though, so you shouldn't. But yeah, so we'll use the Q module, and I'll go into that more when we actually look at the example. But if we weren't using Gappy or our own contrived like jQuery solution, we'd be using the HTTP, which means we don't have to use Q. I'm just going to throw that in there. So we're going to look at the example now. Oops. Let's start with, where do we want to start? Okay, let's just start with the HTML. Sure, this is kind of small, so didn't expect that. But what this is our Angular app, and this might look really intimidating maybe if you're new, but you're JavaScript developers, you're used to stuff looking a little weird. But what we have, so we have this ng app on our HTML, right? So this ng app, and you can move this wherever you want to actually make your app work. Right, I can move it there. It's the same thing, as long as it's on top of my controller that I'm using, right? But this just says, load the module Plunker and use that as my application module. And so when we get down here to the body, we see there's an ng controller. So the ng controller is named file list. There's a controller somewhere called file list, and it's going to control this section of code. So then you've also got here some normal HTML looking stuff, right? We got a form, table, looks legit. If we look at the form, I'm using Bootstrap, so that would explain like the CSS stuff that I've got. But I've got this cool little thing here. What's this? ng submit. So this is like putting a submit handler on your form. In this case, when submit happens, it's actually going to call my scope function search, and it's going to pass it query. Where's query? Well, let's look down here. Input type search. Ng model equals query. So whenever I type into this input box, Angular is going to take care of updating this variable called query on my scope. That's pretty cool. Then I've got a button, and we all know the buttons submit in a form, so that's what it does. So whenever I click on this, it's going to trigger this ng submit. So what else do I have here? Got a table, got a table head, got a table body. What is it? ng repeat file and files. That's cool. What's that do? Well, files is going to be an array in our app, in our scope, I mean. And we're going to, for each entry in the array, we're going to repeat a tr element. That's pretty cool. So normally this is like 6,000 lines of jQuery, right? And jQuery is short. So this creates all my TRs, keeps them updated. Whenever my scope variable files changes, automatically changes here. I don't do any updating. I don't do any listening for events. It's all taken care of in Angular. It's almost scary at first how cool it is, right? When you first see an app like this work, you're like, I don't know why I ever picked up jQuery. So, and I'm a diehard jQuery fan. Don't get me wrong. So in our TR, we have two TDs. The first one is an image. And I try to, again, throw in as much stuff as I can throw at you. It also has an ng source. You're like, what? That's different from source. Yes, it's different from source. Because browsers might pick up the source attribute a little faster than we'd like in Angular, right? Because it's done in JavaScript, so it might be a little delayed. So this is the way that Angular can actually inject the source attribute for you a little later on. It's inconsequential for this example. But in this case, what we're doing is we're sticking in the file.thumbnail link as the value for the source. So as you can guess, this is a URL to a thumbnail. The next TD. We have an anchor. Again, we've got ng-href instead of href for the same reason. So you should be able to put this in an href attribute, and it would probably work. But if somebody clicked on it real fast, sometimes it's going to have that actual curly brace stuff in there and not be compiled with Angular. And so that's why you're just recommended to go ahead and use ng-source. Use ng-href, and then let Angular take care of in doing that. And again, you know, you can stick in your own stuff here. It doesn't have to be. You know, but in this case it is, but it doesn't have to be. And then we have file.title. Do you have a question?
Yeah, you don't want to use ng-source. You need to use ng-source or else the browser will request something.
That is correct. Yes, that is true. He said you need to use ng-source because the browser requests something that doesn't exist. That is correct.
Do you need a public variable?
So there are, yeah, so do I have to use curly braces when I'm assigning things to the, what was the last part?
Yeah, that's NGS, obviously, that's, you know, built into our feedback. Normally, you don't need a curly brace when you assign.
It depends on the value that goes in it. That's what it depends on. So in this case, since I can mix with regular just text, I have to use the curly braces. So it's gonna evaluate that differently. In the case of like ng repeat file and files, I can't just stick in, you know, like it, that doesn't make any sense, right? So that's why they don't require it there, because there's no reason you'd ever do that. So yeah, you can, if you look at the docs, a lot of them will point that out. I don't remember what they call them one way or the other, but yeah, you just have to look. Good question though. So I also have this tr ng hide on files.length with a call span of 2, no results. So in this case, if my array has a length, I won't show this, right? It's a little double negative for you. But this is just to like be like a loading holder, right? Really simple. So where do you guys want to start? Should we start at the low level and work upward, or the top level and work down? Top down. All right, I'm going to take that as in gappy up, not app down. I'm enjoying this. I don't know if you guys are. So here I've created a module called Goog.
Can you just show a demo?
Oh, you want to see the whole thing first? That's kind of cheating. Jeez. Let's see if this will work. So Plunker is really kind of finicky when it comes to, oh, it popped up a window here. Okay. I don't believe this worked, as in, I don't actually believe it did anything. Yeah, I don't think, oh, it did work. Look at that. Oh, it really is finicky. I mess with this forever. I finally figured out, yeah, I can't be logged into two accounts at once. Not the app is finicky. That actually works fine. It's just hosting on Plunker is weird. So in this case, I searched for T. Things with T came back, and you can see my thumbnails, you can see the titles here. And if I click on this guy, you'll see that it's downloading as a PDF. That's cool, right? So yeah, all right. Is that cool enough for you? Is that a good demo? Okay, cool. I mean, that's essentially what it is. I don't have a contrived example for this, but if I had multiple, multiple pages of things with the same query, it also does pagination. And I can change my query here too, right? I can search for, I don't have any good search queries, I'm sorry. So there we go. There's some other things. Pretty cool. They're just minified. That's exactly right. So if we go back over here, and Plunker doesn't crash from previewing in the same window, we can look at our module. So we've got this module I'm storing as Goog. And that's going to be angular.module. And I name it Goog. It's the same as my variable. It doesn't have to be, right? But this is what Angular is going to look at as the value to inject. It doesn't care anything about this. This is just for me. So in this case, the reason I have these empty braces over here, or empty square brackets, is because I'm not depending on anything. Like I said, this is like the top down, right? So this one is the base library that I'm going to use. And then if we look a little bit further down, we've got these constants. So here I've got Gappy URL. I need to download Gappy. So there's that. That's a good constant. That's not going to change. See, I got this client ID. That's a constant. Yeah, that makes sense. I'm not going to change my client ID. My API key, that's a constant. Sure. Okay, I got a value here. Why did I use a value for scopes and then it's an empty array? That's interesting. We'll come back to that. So I also have this run function. So I told you config runs before the dependency injector is done, right? But run runs after the dependency injector is done. So that's how I can inject these other things here. So you can see I'm injecting scopes, which is a value. I'm injecting my key, my client ID, and Gappy itself. But I haven't gotten to Gappy yet. So here we go. Here's my constructor. So goog.gappy, it's a function, takes the root scope. It takes the queue module we talked about briefly. It takes log, just to log in case you're, oh, yes. That's correct. The reason that's usually okay, oh yeah, I keep forgetting to do that. So he asked, my API key is here, and all of you guys can just go steal it. My client ID is even here. You guys can just go steal it, right? And yes, you can, but a well-formed API usually has some kind of restrictions around like where that API key can be used from. In this case, I've set it so that I can only do auth from plunker.co, that kind of thing. But yes, that is an issue. I think modern stuff is pretty good in that using your API key and leaving it publicly really only tells them who's using it and doesn't really do any kind of authentication.
So basically the requirement is you would restrict the scope where the key can be used from to the address to the domain of your application.
Right. You would restrict the key to wherever it should be used from, correct. Whoever owns the key should tell you where it's coming from. Maybe google.com, maybe foo.com, right? Mm-hmm. Okay. So in this case, this is going to be a service. So I say goog.service. I'm going to name my service Gappy, and it's going to use the constructor goog.gappy. So it's going to then inject all this stuff into my constructor, and you can see for the most part, I'm just storing it into my class. But wait, what's this? Loaded. This.q.defer. So that's what I was talking about with the queue module. So what this does is it creates a deferred object. And now loaded is this deferred object that has a promise, it has a resolve, and it has a reject method. So in that case, later on, I can resolve loaded when my API actually gets loaded. I can reject it if it's a 404 or some other kind of server error or whatever else I want to do. And I can promise it by returning that promise to anybody that needs to depend on my loading of the API to do any work. In this case, you can see this.ready is just a duplicate of the loaded promise, and you'll see why in a minute. Let's go ahead and load Gappy from the Gappy URL that was injected. And here we go, loading Gappy. So I'm going to create a global function called Gappy loaded. I'm going to bind it to this. I'm going to do some logging. When it gets loaded, I'm going to resolve. I'm going to digest my scope. So this is the magic here. So when you use the queue module, so I told you you can have these promises that you resolve or reject. That's very true. But one thing that might not be apparent, but I'm pretty sure somebody's pointed out in the comments on the website, is that you have to digest a scope before it's actually digested. So in this case, if we just resolved the loaded promise, nothing would happen if we just took this line out. And that's because, And that's because, I don't know why. Seems to me like any time you'd want to do that, I guess the reason would be you don't want to apply the scope in every successful or not unsuccessful resolve or reject, right? You just want to do it all at once. So if you have multiple promises that you want to resolve or reject, you want to save them all up and do like one digestion of the scope, because I guess that's pretty much the expensive part of this. So that's why I have that digest there. And what does that mean? So that tells Angular, in this case, this is like a callback, right? So this should look pretty boilerplate down here. I'm creating a script tag. I'm sticking it on the page. My computer's being very slow and not highlighting, but hopefully it's not broken. Okay, it might be broken. Oh, there we go. So this is just creating a script tag, and this is a callback. And so when the callback gets done, that means that my script's loaded, the callback happened from the script, I resolve my loaded, because it's loaded, and then I also digest the scope. And so at this point, anything that's depending on the loaded promise will be resolved. Pretty cool. So, geez, what the heck? It's a Mac. I think it's done. Oh, it is done. All right. I think it's actually because that was a child window. I blame it on Plunker, actually. The Plunker does this, it's really neat when it works, but it's really annoying when it doesn't, where if you make changes, you can see live changes elsewhere. So it's like constantly doing this JavaScript communication. But I think they have a few optimizations to make. Plunker, by the way, was written in Angular. Let's go back to Gappy. So, well, if it's a good thing or a bad thing. It's a good thing. I was kidding. So we load that. Let's see here. Dadgummit, it's at the same point every time. Well, Apologies. Oh, there we go. All right, I'm trying to figure out where I am, actually. Okay, I know where I am. Okay, so we've loaded. Oh my gosh. Okay, we'll get a few more lines of scroll back. So what I do is I say run, right? Let's come back to this guy. So at this point, all that's happened because that was all in the constructor of Gappy. So that happens when it gets dependency injected, right? So the first time it happens, it's right here in this run function. Gappy gets constructed, passed in. So now I have this Gappy object. I can say Gappy.off. That's totally legit. And I'll pass in the key scopes client ID and false. So what is all that? So here, let's look at auth. So this is going to authorize the API. In a simple case, it might just be giving it the API key, right? Because some APIs don't require authentication. But in our case, we've got our client ID, we've got our scopes that we need, so we're going to pass all that in and we're going to do actual OAuth. So if we scroll down this a little bit, we got self equals this, we got an auth callback, an auth timeout, an auth function, we got if scopes.length. Oh, this is cool. So if scopes.length, what does that mean? So self.authorize. Oh, this is another deferred object. So we'll create another deferred object and store it in self.authorize. Then we'll say self.ready. Remember, self.ready before was just loaded's promise, right? But wait, what is this? So now self.ready, we're changing it. So we're taking the queue module, and now we're combining all of the promises that are passed in right here. So in this case, it's going to be not only when it's loaded, because it might not have been loaded yet. We don't know. We haven't done anything with the actual API. Not only when it's loaded, but also when we've authorized, because scopes.length tells us we need to have authorization scopes. So it's going to combine those and make that the self.ready promise. So here, we say self.loaded.promise, then auth. So now we're waiting. So at this point, this is our callback, right? So when that loaded promise gets resolved, then we'll auth. It looks pretty cool. I can read this. It makes sense in English. And then what? I return self.ready.promise. So now if anything is waiting on me to authenticate, it can do so like that. So if we look up here at auth, it's going to set my API key. It's going to check some scopes.length. It's going to do this weird window pop-up thing. It's going to do this timeout where you do this authorize the client ID of the scope. I mean, this is all Gappy stuff. I won't go into it because it's not really the point of this. But essentially, it gets to the point where it has the auth callback, and it's making sure that we're authorized, at which point, again, it's going to resolve or reject the authorized. And here you can see both the use of the reject and the resolve. And then it's going to digest our scope. Right? So that's pretty cool. That's the Gappy module. That's all it is, except for this request. So this is just how you do a request in Gappy. Again, not part of this really demonstration, but it is cool to look at. Essentially what it does, it creates a deferred object, returns the deferred object's promise for the request. So you can see here kind of going through here, let's see, requesting, request promise, return deferred.promise. But this is a pretty simple, this doesn't use the cool like Gappy like JavaScript object way of doing it. This just uses a straight up Gappy.client.request method. But Gappy's really cool. You should definitely look into it if you haven't already. Let's look at our drive.js. So this one's really cool. We create this drive module. It depends on Goog, you can see here. So everything that's in module Goog will be available to our drive module. So what does that mean? What we got here? So we got a config. So what is this? I'm using the provide injection, right? What is that going to do for me? I'm actually creating a decorator. You didn't think you'd see one of those, huh? So what do? I decorate scopes. So you saw scopes was just an empty array earlier, right? What was I doing with that? You can't have empty scopes. How does it get filled in? Here. So I'm taking scopes, I'm injecting it, and here's this delegate, and then I take the delegate and I push onto it all the scopes that I need. And I think this is actually a too expansive set of scopes, but you get the point. I push these scopes on here, and in this way, you can have a drive module, you can have a Gmail module, you can have a maps module, and they can all decorate scopes and add in their own scopes to it so that there's only one OAuth call that has to happen, and you can get authorization for all those scopes if you want. So it's a cool way to use the decorator. Yeah? So then, Again, this is a little bit contrived. So I have drive.value list request, right? So again, I can manipulate this at a later module. I can change maybe the max results to 10 or something like that, right? But this is just going to make available an injectable list request object that looks just like this guy that I put in line. So we also have this factory. The factory is a function here. Well, it will be a function. So the factory takes log, gappy, and list request. So I have some storage here where I'm keeping this stuff. It's kind of like caching, right? So it just returns this function. It's going to, you know, reference this closure to do searching. So you can see my list files function will end up taking a title and an optional MIME type. So we'll copy our list request. We'll stick in the page token if we have one. We'll clear out our files. We'll fill in the MIME type and the query. We'll log some stuff. We'll do this request. And then after we get the request promise resolved, we'll do this, right? So we just log that we received a response. We'll store our page token, and then we'll just concatenate our returned files onto our list of files that we have already. So in that case, you can do pagination just by extending it kind of thing. It's just really simple, okay? But I also have a filter, and we didn't talk about filters because they're not really provisions, but they kind of are. They're almost like provided to the template, right? So if we look back at our index real quick, you'll see here that I have this ng-href file pipe PDF link. And that's because the PDF link that's returned from the Drive API has a slash in it. And you know those don't work really well as JavaScript strings or JavaScript strings. So what I can't just stick in here. I can't say file.pdf/link or whatever it was, right? That doesn't work. So I've created this cool little filter. And what that does is it takes anything. In this case, it's taking a file object. And it's piping it through this PDF link filter. And you can make them any way you want. It could just take the export links object and get the PDF link out of it or whatever. I chose to take the whole file. So in this case, the input, if there is no input, which sometimes, you know, if it hasn't loaded yet, it might be no input. If there is no input, just return an empty string. But if there is an input, we'll look in export links and return application/PDF. And that's going to be a link to the PDF download. So lastly, we have our app.js. It's pretty sweet, huh? It's like 10 lines. So once I have this whole library set up, right, which really, I mean, you could argue, it's not bad at all. We had a few functions, but we've covered a lot of stuff. And when I actually go to implement my application, I just depend on this factory list files, and then I create my scope. It's got a search. It takes a query. List files. So here it is. Here's my factory I'm using. List files, I call it with the query. That's going to return my promise, like you saw, and you should look at it again later just to totally get this because this is going 100 miles a minute. Then we'll take those files and we'll print them out, and then we'll put them on our scope, and that's it. Angular takes care of the rest. So once we store to this variable here, this property, it's going to update our HTML for us, like you saw with the TRNG repeat. So that's kind of a really cool working example of something that's actually applicable maybe to you or I. So I know, like, in my stuff that I do here, totally unrelated to really anything. It's all internal stuff. But, I mean, we use Gappy for accessing to the internal Google APIs. And so I do this kind of stuff all the time, just, like, messing with these Google APIs through Gappy. And so I thought it was really cool to actually see a short working demo, and I hope you did as well. And at this time, if you have any questions about this application, please ask.
Where can people find this online?
Yes. Where can people find this online? I'll answer that one really quick. Dadgummit. I'm not used to this presentation. So you can email me at wnagooglers.com, or you can look at this presentation at this URL. I minified it, so it might be easier, might be harder to read. You can read it. Yeah, we can put a link to it somewhere, I'm sure. But I would definitely recommend looking at all the slides, all the plunks that I made, and the app itself. I think there's a lot of cool, interesting things. And if you find anything that I did that's really dumb, please email me. But if it's just a little dumb, don't email me. Yeah. Okay.
So if you had a service built in Angular, you can do a resource thing.
Say that part. What was that? I still didn't get that. I'm sorry.
JavaScript.
Okay. Yeah. Sure.
Robin JSON.
It's a good question. Yeah, why would you do that?
Because I'm putting Angular as the front end layer on the pre-existing Rails app, which has a function template rendering through Maven. And while the eventual target is a full function web API through JSON, Maven today is everything everywhere in JSON is necessarily possible.
Sure. So, I think that is a good idea. I think, because I definitely don't deal with that myself, to post to the group. So he was trying to ask for the best way to take JavaScript, the actual code, not a JavaScript object, from the HTTP get or post or whatever, and actually put that on the page. Is that correct? Okay. Yeah, that's a good question. I would say that if you already have a way you're doing it to make it work with Angular, I would definitely use the Q module. But I don't know. That's a good question.
Okay. I think we're ready to get started if you want to file back. I'm going to ask you for Q&A to use the microphone. It's on a stand, which is embarrassing. But if you put your hand up, I can see if we can maybe make the cord reach to the back chairs if you don't want to get up. But then people on YouTube will be less upset with not hearing the questions. So would you rather, Greg, would you rather we held questions to the end and then we went into full-on Q&A?
Well, if you have relevant questions during the presentation, please ask them, and we'll do general Q&A afterwards.
Okay, so this is Greg Weber, and he's here to give us a short talk.
All right, thank you. As I said, please feel free to ask questions. We're using AngularJS to develop Facebook app. There's a lot of stuff going on. I don't know if I have proper network connectivity to that stuff is going to work or not, but lots of buttons you can click, different tabs and things like that. There's a fair amount of complexity in the UI. So what this presentation is about is dealing with complexity, which I think was someone's concern in the last question. So I think that was a great segue. All right, so. There's many different tools that are at our disposal to deal with complexity. The first thing is you probably need to choose some kind of framework. So we're going to assume you chose AngularJS for at least the beginning parts of this talk. So this is a good choice. The different frameworks have different pros and cons. So I think you need to choose a framework that has good two-way data binding. There are other frameworks out there. AngularJS is the only one that operates based on, propagates the data binding based on efficient dirty checking. And the benefit of that is that we can use just plain old JavaScript objects. We don't have to always extend objects from our framework. And that gives us flexibility. We don't get it trapped into the framework, and at least in that aspect that we have to use framework objects that can know how to signal each other. But this doesn't mean that AngularJS is the best. It just means it's different than other frameworks. Other frameworks have their own advantages. In AngularJS, we'll keep the view up to date based on data in the controller. And AngularJS has a brilliant, this is a brilliantly simple programming model when things are simple. When we do a HTTP request in the controller, get the data back, assign it to the scope, it's automatically updated, beautiful. But the problem is that as we grow an application, we need to start taking code out of the controller, put it into a service, which that alone is fine and doesn't necessarily introduce problems. But then, as the user interface gets more complex, we're gonna have multiple controllers communicating via that service, and now we're out of the nice, perfect, simple world where everything just works easily every time, and we have to find design patterns that we're gonna use to wrangle this complexity. On the left is our simple controller. It does the request, it gets the data back. On the right is our complex controller where we have two controllers, and they're both operating on the service. So I apologize, I'm kind of mixing in some CoffeeScript. If you see an arrow, it just means there's a function there. But this code stuff is really simple. You just need to conceptually understand it, really. So our service returns an object with the data field. In our first controller, we say scope.data is equal to that service.data, and so we have the correct data in the service. But now in the second controller, we want to change that data. So we call the service method to change the data. And now if we look at our change data method in service, the key is that it assigns an entirely new value to the data field. And now in our first controller, we still have the original data and we don't get the new data. So now we're starting to see that the UI complexity is going to lead to a little more complexity that we're going to have to find some patterns to deal with. So one way that we could deal with this is by placing data on the root scope, and I don't think this was mentioned in the earlier presentations, but or maybe it was. AngularJS has like a watch service, so we could place data on a root scope and use a watch service, but this is essentially, you know, using global variables. So it can lead to collisions, and we'd also like the ability to have scopes that are isolated, and when you isolate a scope, this is gonna get messed up. So it's not really a nice approach. So another approach that we can use is using events, and I think this is the one that the last question was before this talk was, I'm using events and it's getting a little bit ugly. So I guess that's kind of my opinion on events, is like it's pretty easy for them to start to get a little bit ugly. I have some sample code here, and so we're using the broadcast, emit, and on to communicate between the different controllers. So the problem is that one of the problems is that we're using strings. So we're a typo away from saying, you know, what the heck happened here and why didn't this work? There's a library called Signals that it's basically events, but it doesn't use strings. So it'd be possible to try to use events, but use a library like that where it tries to make the events more, type safe. If you will. I haven't really looked into that in detail. AngularJS provides us, as almost everybody every other framework does, a string-based event system. The usage of events can, if you just want to communicate from controller A to controller B, the usage of events is a little more obscure because in AngularJS you're broadcasting and emitting up and down a whole hierarchy of controllers. So, and if you want to find where the string is used, you're going to search through the string. It's a little nicer to use services. You have a service in one controller, you have a service in another, and it's a little easier to see how they're put together. So I think events are the perfect tool for integrating things from the outside world that aren't meshing that well with AngularJS. In an ideal world, we would properly put everything into a directive or whatever, but sometimes you want to get things done more quickly than that, and events are a good tool for communicating in from the outside world. So here's another approach. We can communicate between two controllers through a service using getters. So in the vented approach, we listen for a change and we broadcast data. So in one controller, we're sending, we're listening for the event, and another controller, we're broadcasting a change. So in the getter style, what we can do is we say in our fail example, we had scope.data equals service.data, directly take the value. In this example, we have scope.data equals service.getData. So the key is now that we're using this getter function. So rather than having a constant value that's just going to get slipped out from underneath us, this function will return a new value every single time. Well, but obviously it'll be the same most of the time, and we'll rely on Angular's efficient dirty checking to know when it's changed and to update the view. So our other controller can call the change data function. The change data function can change the data variable, give it an entirely new reference, and then our get data function will automatically get the latest value for us. So this is a pretty good way to deal with the issue. So let's see. Another approach that it reduces boilerplate, but in other ways it kind of places some burdens on your programming style, is that our problem in our fail example was that we had a reference to an object and then a new object got put in its place. But if we have a reference to an object and we always maintain that reference to the object and we just mutate the object, AngularJS can deal with that really nicely. So in our service, we have the data object. That's an array. So in our service has a change data function. So one controller can call this change data function. That'll kick off our HTTP request. We're going to get back data. And now what we're going to do is, instead of creating an entirely new array and assigning that to our data variable, what we're going to do is mutate the array. So we're going to set the length to 0. That clears out all the existing data in the array, and then we're going to push on all of the new data. So we've accomplished the same thing as if we had assigned an entirely new array. But we've maintained the same reference. We've mutated the array. We cleared it out. Added the other data in. So now in our second controller that's using the data, we can just say scope.data equals service.data. We don't even need a getter here, because it's that data is always referring to the same object, and it's never going to get changed out from underneath us. Uh, Does this make sense to people?
What is the three dots?
Well, in this case, that means like that would be where your URL would be. Yeah, like that's your request URL.
I thought I had some
meaning. Yeah. Did I miss?
Do you have a question?
Oh, no. No question. You have a question? Okay. So HTTP will create an asynchronous call. So in your controller, when you will call scope.data, like when exactly are you going to populate this data? When the service actually will kick it off success method? Yeah, exactly. So in the controller, it starts off, the data would be will be empty, mm-hmm. and then when that hits success, that'll finally get populated, and it will get then get populated in the controller and in
so
the view.
So pretty much for like a brief like moment, you're not gonna have anything in your data, and then once HTTP is gonna come back, that's when the whole like magic is gonna happen on binding.
Yeah. Yep. All right. And I should probably say that I'm even using this to stream tweets. Sorry, I should show the streaming animation, but they'll just start coming in, and so I have this array of tweets. And the controller, this method is actually superfluous. It's like massaging the data. Maybe I should have put it in the service. So, this is the controller for streaming tweets. It gets the messages. Messages for is just. It's a namespacing because there's multiple places in the application that can stream tweets at the same time. So this is a helper here, so it's a little bit superfluous to our point also. So this is a little bit superfluous, the namespacing. So we have like, say it's, let's just say we have, originally I just had a messages service and it wasn't messages for until I had the deal with namespacing. So it's just scope.tweets equals messages service dot stream tweets. So that, and all this does is give back the array. It also kicks off the API call. But all this actually does is it starts by returning an empty array, and then it will change that array. And this is also kind of superfluous. So this is all we have in our controller. It's which is nice. We have everything back in the service and the controller doesn't have to do complex things. Sorry, what was that? What was your question? I think we don't have time here, and maybe I'll do this in another presentation. But you see a bunch of CoffeeScript in this, but I'm kind of switching into using TypeScript now, that. Weird because that was actually CoffeeScript mixed with TypeScript. I wouldn't recommend doing that. It's just a transitional thing for us. It's don't do that. Okay. Oh, don't lose my presentation. Oh, maybe I can do this here too. Okay, so I guess this talk kind of had that was like the first part of the talk, and then I just have a couple pretty much unrelated points to go to. So that was all about AngularJS, like dealing with the basics of communicating through services in a complex UI. So here's a couple other things for dealing with complexity. I'll go over them pretty briefly. So in our application, we have a Facebook feed. So there are all these different types in the feed. So here's the on the right, I have an example of it. In the top picture, it's a picture from Redneck Island, I think, which is probably a fantastic show. I've never watched it though. And the next feed item is a link, and there can be a video in the feed. There can be like a survey with questions. So these are really pretty unrelated. There's some underlying commonalities, but they have a lot of differences. So the original code we had had one schema or one object type to model this with, and there was like a whole bunch of potential null or undefined fields. Because each record, so like our photo type has a photos field, and our video type has a video link field. The video type is not supposed to have a photos field. The photo type is not supposed to have a video link field. So we found a library called ADTJS that stands for algebraic data types, and it allowed me to properly model this kind of data. So I still have a dry schema. So, sorry, this is CoffeeScript again on the left. Looks a little weird because I have these custom merge methods. And so I'm using the merging to basically do inheritance of the fields. So there's some commonality and some differences. So our code, before I had to like look in the documentation to figure out if this... there was just a kind field. I had to look at the kind field, look at our documentation to figure out if the object had the correct fields or not. Now it's being enforced through this library. So I'm using this as a basic data layer, basically. So it's something you might be interested in checking out. So this maybe gets us back on track with directly with dealing with the complex UI a little more. There's this concept of state charts. So if I showed you the original user interface, and we have these multiple tabs, and there are these tabs on the left, and I want to go click on this one. I'm going to go over the guide tab, and when I come back to this tab, it should know that I was here. And we can have pop-ups, so a lot of interactions, and we want to be smart about remembering what happened, where the user is, where they can go. Figure out what should happen every time we make these kind of user interface transitions. So somebody came up with the concept of the state chart. It's not user interface specific. It's basically a tool for dealing with complexity. Usually people just use a bunch of implicit state mutation, and eventually somewhere along the line it gets messed up, and you write tests and you do a bunch of QA, but the implicit state mutation generally just leads to bugs as you grow in complexity. So what this does, it allows us to be very explicit about what states are allowed in the user interface. So we start from a root state, I have to go into an authentication state, and then I get into the logged in state. So state chart is like a finite state machine on steroids. So I'll go into the display state, and then this has multiple possible substates. Each one of these was a tab, essentially one of the main tabs in the user interface. And then these states were sidebars in this tab. These states were more selections within this tab. And then I also have it also allows for concurrent states. So there's a concurrent pop-up state going up, so I can have one pop-up open at a time, and that can be the settings pop-up, or it can be a show detail pop-up, and when it's not open, the pop-up is closed. So this way, we're very explicit about the state. I can explain this diagram to people, and every time we do a state transition, I make sure that every time I do a state transition, there's code that gets run. So here I'm doing saying when I enter the login state, load the users load this user data. I guess I only have enters here, but you can also register code that's run on exit. So the beauty is, you know, this will always be run when the user transitions through different states of the user interface. And so here's when you go into the guide state, it activates the guide tab. And there's default states and history states, which you remember where you should be going to. So I guess I talked about one alternative to finite state machines, which is implicit state mutation, to state charts, implicit state mutation. Another is using finite state machines. I really like the nesting of state charts, though, so finite state machines don't have nesting. I think people tend to use routing for some of this. So routing doesn't deal well with concurrent states or nested states that well, or remembering history of the multiple different places the user could have been very well. So it's not quite the full solution either. So I think I read that Ember framework was working on incorporating state charts with routing, which I'm not actually doing routing right now in my application, but I would probably I think I can incorporate AngularJS routing with the state chart fairly easily. So there's an existing library for this called Stativus. There are some other libraries that I found that didn't seem to be well maintained, or were GPL libraries, and I wanted an MIT library. I found the Stativus library to be a little lacking in some regards. So I wrote my own, and I'll be open sourcing that. So if this interests you, you can contact me, and I'll probably have this open source next week. So are the state charts making sense to people? So the main thing is, you just say state.goto, you go to the next state. I have logging in the application, so it says, okay, you're entering authenticate, now you're entering logging logged in, so I can see exactly what state I'm in as I'm developing. Oop.
Do you have a name for your library so we can?
My approach is tree based, so I think I'm going to call it something like tree state chart. It's like I'm really thinking of state charts as trees. It's probably overly simplistic, but it's like what's working for my use cases. But you can just email me. I'll give you a card or something.
Actually, if you send it to me, we can put it on the Google Plus page, and when we post the slides to YouTube, we can also make sure we include it in the description.
Thanks. So that's it for my presentation. I know some of you are more beginners. I hope that this will help you avoid some pitfalls, I hope it helps people recognize that, AngularJS is not perfect. You're going to have to, as things get complex, you're going to have to figure new things out. And I hope some of the more experienced people can give me feedback on the techniques, and maybe they have some different ones of their own they can explain to me. So.
I have a question back about the communication between the controllers.
Yeah.
So you had two examples that I like. One is the mutation based, another is based on function call. Can you give anything, comparison between these two, pros and cons, or maybe have you profiled those, or what is the best practice? Basically, that's what I was talking about.
I seem to really like the mutation for arrays. I can't say that I've actually. I guess I'm not at the point yet to make an opinion as this is better or not. But I would say if you're going to do the mutation, do it for arrays. And then if you're doing an object, you're probably going to want to use the getter as a starting point. So. Okay, so.
Should we do some
Q&A? Yeah, so I guess people want to leave now, they can, and we'll be doing some Q&A.
I think actually we've. Thank you, Greg. I think we probably only have time for about two or three questions. I'm going to ask you to use the mic, and I'm going to rely on are helpful volunteers with more experience than I have to hopefully field them. So, I don't know, does anybody have any general Angular questions they want to ask? Is the mic too intimidating? Have you asked all your questions? Oh, a tentative hand?
I've got one. And I've asked a similar question a few meetups back, but I the question is, has anybody created services that they've used in AngularJS but also been able to reuse in another MVC framework? If so, how do they, what techniques did they use and how are, how did that work out?
I can say going from the other direction, I've been able to integrate other code with Angular, like through events, as I mentioned. And there, I haven't really gone the other way, but that may be a good. To a certain extent, it's a question about how do you do that? Like, get a service out of Angular, possibly, maybe. In that case. But.
I mean, one of the nice things about Angular is that since it's just vanilla JavaScript, then it's really easy to mix with other things. I guess it really depends on your use case and like which MVC framework you're going to use with it, because I think it fits in differently with each case. But I think it's one of those frameworks where you can take bits and pieces of it and work it into your code, right? So I can't give you a concrete example because I don't have a concrete example, right? But for the most part, it just works with pretty much whatever you have. Obviously, handlebars might be a little different because it uses handlebars itself. But if you use the interpolate provider, you can change the handlebars even. So you could even use other templating languages that use the same symbols, etc.
Maybe an answer is if you give a more concrete case on the mail list, you'll be able to get a better answer.
Can you use the mic?
So in the past, I've written tests, Jasmine tests, querying the DOM with jQuery, like writing those tests first before the implementation. So how does that compare with the end-to-end testing framework that Angular ships with? Is that a similar approach that it takes? Or like, can you have like a unit test that you write and then you write code and you're sure that if your test passed, your application works for sure with the end-to-end framework in Angular?
I don't know if you're ever completely sure, are you? Angular is really good. It's probably the best that I've found for doing unit tests and really knowing that your application works, because of its vanilla JavaScript, right? Like, you can create these easy mocks, you can create these really simple injections that, you can be pretty sure that it does what you think it's doing. Plus, a lot of the magic's in Angular, so really, don't try to unit test Angular.
Right, but I'm talking specifically about the end-to-end, like, integration test.
Sure. You mean end-to-end test being implied by the unit test? Is there like a thing missing?
I think yeah, first loading the application and actually clicking on the button, simulating
browser actions.
Just Jasmine.
Say that again.
So actually loading the application and manipulating the browser and the buttons and the text and stuff like that. There is something about that.
I guess I don't really get the question.
So there's two types of tests that I've read about in Angular docs. One is straight unit tests, and one is end-to-end tests.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So is the end-to-end tests, is it implemented? I'm trying to understand its implementation. So is it querying the DOM to see if things appear there? Kind of like that, or how does it work really, like the end-to-end testing stuff?
That's a good question. Okay. I couldn't go into it.
So I'd like to suggest if you could ask that question on the group, I can go harass Voita, the author of Testacular, and get him to answer it, or get somebody on the list to answer it. I think it's a good question. I'm sorry, I don't have an answer that's quite as specific tonight. Any other questions? Please stump our panel of experts, semi-experts. All right, well, if nobody has any more questions, I have some Angular stickers. If anybody's dying for a sticker for their laptop, come see me. And if you asked a question or helped answer a question, I have a few t-shirts here. If there happens to be one in your size, come up and say hi. Thank you so much for coming.